Good morning, everyone. My name is Victoria Rocha, and I would like to introduce today our keynote speaker, Danny Murillo. Danny is the co-founder of Underground Scholars Initiative and is currently a graduate student in the Social and Cultural Analysis of Education program at California State University, Long Beach. He is a primary author of the Campaign for College Opportunities latest report, the Possibility Report, From Prison to College Degrees in California. He is a trailblazer, an inspiration, and we are honored to have him here with us today. Please join me in welcoming Danny Murillo.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm gonna try to get these PowerPoint slides up before I start my talking. But first of all, I wanna say good morning, everyone. And thank you, Victoria. I remember a few years ago when I first started doing the statewide work, you were on a panel at Fresno City College and you were still a student at Fresno City College. Years later now, you know, you're a peer mentor, you work at Fresno City College, I believe you're in an undergraduate program at Fresno State. So seeing the progress that you made, it really is a testament to your leadership and to your dedication and your transformation, and it's an honor to see all the work that you've done. I also wanna thank Dr. Cassandra Little. Is it possible to go widescreen on the PowerPoint, please? No, widescreen share.
Ray.
I'm going to try it one more time, Susie.
Go to the display settings at the top, that little down arrow, over a little bit, over to your right, display settings. So where it's next, to the left of where it says in slideshow. Click that. Click the down arrow.
I'm not seeing it. It's covered by another mark. Okay, so display settings.
Click that. And swap. There you go.
I also want to thank Dr. Cassandra Little for the original invitation early last year before being quarantined due to the global pandemic. As she mentioned, the symposium was canceled in the previous year, and here we are now. And now would not be possible without the support of everyone who has worked behind the scenes to make this happen. So a special thank you to you. I also want to give a special shout out and a big thank you to Celia Martinez, Office Specialist from Student Equity and Success, for always responding promptly to my emails and always answering my request for information and answering my questions. Thank you very much for making this process so easy for me. So once again, good morning, everyone. And thank you for joining me this morning for Fresno City College Rising Scholars Fostering Success for Formerly Incarcerated Students Virtual Symposium. It is an honor to be here this morning. I am currently pursuing my Master's of Arts in Education with an option in the Social Cultural Analysis of Education at Cal State Long Beach. And my dream goal is to one day be a faculty member at a California community college teaching Chicano or ethnic studies. I love the learning process and hope when I am in a position to teach, I do it so from, I do it coming into it open to continuous learning and growing from both the lived experience of my students and the theoretical frameworks and practice that we learn in higher education. With that said, let me shift lanes and share some context to the title of my keynote address. Space, time, and community refers to the moments throughout my life that have shaped and influenced my experience for better or for worse. I recognize that these were learning experiences that allowed me to survive that particular environment in that specific moment. Simultaneously, as I grew older and kind of wiser, I found myself in spaces where I saw the world from a different perspective that allowed me to envision a future for myself after incarceration. In these spaces, a significant influence that played a role in my transformation was the people around me. In other words, my community. In these spaces, it wasn't about surviving. It was about thriving. Whether it's an institution of higher learning or prison or the streets, education comes in so many forms. It's what you do with that education that determines the consequences of your choices and the future that awaits you. So before I talk about my future as a faculty member at a, before I talk or even dream about a future as a faculty member at a community college, let me share with you a little bit about my past and how I ended up here today as your keynote speaker. Next slide, please. Thank you. My life experience and the environment where I was raised played a significant role in my formative years growing up in a predominantly Chicano and Mexican immigrant community. My parents are from Zacatecas, Mexico. Before crossing the border, they lived in Tijuana for a couple of years, where two of my older siblings were born and raised. Although born in Tijuana, they were raised their whole lives in Southeast Los Angeles. I am the first of my siblings to be born in the United States, and I have two younger brothers also born in the US with a total of five siblings, and I'm the middle child. There's a big difference between being born here and being a naturalized citizen, especially when it comes to the carceral system. After completing your sentence, a naturalized citizen will more than likely be deported. My home experience was a cultural fusion of different parts of American culture with the predominant influence of Mexican culture that came from my parents, aunts, uncles, and other family members. Family parties were very Mexican because my birthday party would start with mariachi singing Las Mananitas at 8 in the morning. And by the end of the night, everyone drunk dancing to Los Tigres del Norte. As much as I love family parties and Mexican food, I also consumed a lot of American culture throughout my life. In my adolescence, I loved cartoons from Transformers to Thundercats. Me and my siblings were the first kids on our block to have Nintendo in 1986. My older siblings and my parents influenced my taste in music. You know, I recall my sister listening to the whole East Side Story collection, Parliament Funkadelic, Bob Marley, NWA, and other hip hop pioneers. My brother was a big fan of Too Short and Chicano rap. At home, my father was a provider who gave us more than what we needed in terms of material needs. He gave us much more than what he grew up with as a child in Zacatecas, Mexico. My father was the type of person who loved to be the life of the party, the center of attention, you know, at home or work. He celebrated everyone's birthdays at home with the cookout of carnitas, lots of beer and music. At work, he was the same way. Every time his workers finished a job at a construction site, most of his workers, you know, were from his hometown in Zacatecas. And he would, you know, pay to have a pig slaughtered, make carnitas, and of course, with lots of beer and music. My father was also a lifeline to a lot of people. He arrived to the US relatively young and quickly found success in the construction boom of the 1980s. I remember going with my dad as early as 8 years old to visit different construction sites throughout Southern California. There were many school days when I would leave the house to go to school early in the morning, and there's a group of men outside waiting for my dad to give them their work instructions for the day. My father was a subcontractor and the remote man when he was responsible for 2 to 3 work sites with 25 to 50 homes at each site. He was responsible for sending men to these sites to get the job done. Most of these men were family members or they came from the same hometown as my father. Some of these men would also live with us for a couple months. You know, they would combine their savings, you know, combine their savings to rent an apartment together and eventually make enough money to either rent or buy their own home and bring their families over from Mexico. I remember many beautiful moments throughout my early adolescence that I experienced with my family. I remember going on family trips to from LA to El Paso, crossing the border in El Paso to Juarez, and then driving down to Zacatecas, or staying home to watch a pay-per-view fight of Julio Cesar Chavez. It's these moments that I carry with me as a reminder of my family and what a family should be. At the same time, as I carry these memories with me, I also hold the trauma of those moments at home filled with domestic violence. For a few years, it was common to witness acts of domestic violence from my father toward my mother and on some occasions toward my older brother. Next slide, please. Along with the violence at home, I was also exposed to gang violence in my community. By the age of 13, I was an innocent bystander in two gang-related shootings. Being exposed to domestic and gang violence harsh realities prevented my social, emotional, and cognitive development that I would eventually need to thrive into adulthood. At the same time, as a first-generation student, I attended K-12 public schools in my Southeast Los Angeles neighborhood. My experience with public schools I attended was punctuated with negative experiences due to my limited English proficiency and being the son of migrant parents from Mexico. I've often experienced judgment and mockery by my teachers and school administrators for my language difficulties and ethnicity. These actions left me feeling unworthy of an education and unworthy of my teachers' time or investment. My escape from this harsh reality occurred when I was playing baseball. In the baseball field, I felt free from the physical and psychological violence that I was experiencing at home, in my community, and the schools that I attended. You know, it was in the baseball field that, you know, it was just a place, you know, where I found, you know, it was my sanctuary. You know, I wouldn't even ask my mom or my father to come watch me play because, you know, I didn't want to be reminded of anything other than my love for baseball. And it was just those moments that were moments for myself. Next slide, please. It was not surprising then that I was convinced I did not belong when I started high school and had minimal hopes for my future. By the time I started my freshman year at Zhongdan High School, I had lost interest in school. I started ditching class with my friends, and it was during this time I began experimenting with drugs. I felt alone, angry, and without the necessary resources to help me cope with the traumas and struggles I was experiencing. I found an outlet in the streets of my community. I did not know how to express all the anger and pain I carried with me. And it wasn't long before I joined a local street gang. I also recall at this time negotiating my involvement as a street gang member. There were limitations to my participation in street gang activity. I preferred to make money selling weed or breaking into cars instead of participating in gang violence. On the first day of 10th grade, I was expelled from high school after I never returned to school. Like so many other Black and brown boys like me, these experiences inevitably put me in the school to prison pipeline. It wasn't long before I was arrested for possession of crack cocaine with the intent to sell, and I found myself incarcerated in a juvenile facility. Next slide, please. That's my youngest brother right there in the picture with me. I was arrested on December 31st, 1994. Not long after my arrest, I was sentenced to 6 months in the Los Angeles County probation camp system. Initially, I was transferred to Camp Challenger in Lancaster. And after a certain amount of time, I was supposed to get shipped to a fire camp. But all that changed when I volunteered to play a game of softball. And next thing you know, I'm being sent to Camp Kilpatrick, which is a sports camp. This camp was featured in a movie titled The Gridiron Gang with The Rock and Exhibit. Once again, baseball plays an essential role during another difficult moment in my life. It gave me the opportunity to escape the reality of incarceration by playing on the camp's baseball team. And once again, I found myself while incarcerated at Camp Kilpatrick, continuing to negotiate my involvement in gang and criminal activity. When I was released, I decided that I would focus on making money selling drugs, mainly crack cocaine. It was so easy to get wholesale and even easier to triple my investment in retail. And I wasn't interested or had any kind of inclination to engage in violence, right? And even though I have been exposed to violence and it was something that was already normalized, you know, I still had this, you know, and it wasn't about you know, of being afraid to do time, because I was willing to do the time. I just wasn't at that place yet where I was willing to take someone's life, you know? And it's kind of sad that there was a process to that, to get to that point, right? Next slide, please. About 2 months before my release, two of my friends were shot. One passed away and the other one was in critical condition and confined to a wheelchair. I was coming home from Camp Kilpatrick to a community that was in grief, in pain. And I remember the day I was released, I went to the hospital to visit my friend. And I remember after seeing my friend confined to a hospital bed with the look of malnutrition and more than 10 bullet wounds in his body, the only thing that was going through my mind was seeking revenge against those who did this to my friends. It was at this point that I was no longer negotiating my involvement. I reached the point of no return, and engaging in acts of gang violence became part of my daily life and identity. At the same time, I was also involved in the distribution of crack cocaine in my community. You know, when I first came home, a friend who was incarcerated let me borrow $1,200 to purchase 2 ounces of crack cocaine. And, you know, 8 months later, you know, I was buying and selling up to 10 to 12 ounces of crack cocaine every 2 weeks. You know, keep in mind that I was 16 years old at this age, and I was pretty much running a business, right? And if I had the skills to do that at 16 years old, imagine what could I have accomplished had the right resources and the right opportunities have been presented to me to be able to take those skills in a positive direction, right? But unfortunately, in my community, those opportunities are very, very rare. Next slide, please. In 1996, at the age of 16 years young, I was arrested for 2 armed robberies. I spent the next 2 years fighting my case, and I eventually took a plea bargain along with my 3 co-defendants. The plea bargain was 15 years for me and 2 of my co-defendants, and a 25-year to life sentence for one of my co-defendants who had just finished serving some prison time and already had a felony conviction. Because our case carried multiple felony convictions, he fell under California's 3-strike law and was sentenced to a life sentence, even though he didn't even go to trial. That was the plea bargain. In order for me to get 15 years, he had to take a life sentence. And it was a decision that he made to take a life sentence to basically give us an opportunity to one day come home. You know, and I don't even know if you want to call it a plea bargain, right? 15 years, you know, my plea bargain was a 15-year sentence in California state prison with 2 felony convictions. However, the possibility existed that I could be sent to California Youth Authority to serve my time, which would only be half of the time. Unfortunately, California Youth Authority recommended I be sent to prison because of the amount of time I was serving, the nature of the crime, and the people and my co-defendants. All of them which had served time in California Youth Authority and state prison. So as a teenager, you know, I've already been sentenced to 15 years. I'm supposed to serve 12 years out of this 15-year sentence. I have 2 felonies, you know, anything that can be possibly charged with the felony in prison can possibly just, you know, end up giving me a life sentence, right? So, you know, I went to prison thinking that I was never gonna get out, right? Even though my friend took a life sentence, right? So that one day I could come home. My first few years going to prison, you know, I operated from the place of possibly never coming home, right? And that was my reality. Next slide, please. Initially, I first arrived at Wasco State Prison on my 18th birthday. I stayed in Wasco for 2 months until I was transferred to High Desert State Prison in February 1998. In my first few years in prison, I operated from the perspective that I might not ever get out. On a couple of occasions, I volunteered to participate on assault on other incarcerated people, but I was never sent because there were people there in prison who wanted me to come home. Even when I had given up hope for myself, others were still hoping for something better for me. I remember at this point in my life, I had been swept into the dustbin of history, forgotten by family and friends. Since the first day of my incarceration, it was my mother who had always been by my side. And she's, you know, the whole 14 years, you know, when I say that, who was my longest cellmate, you know, I always say it was my mother. Even though she was not physically in that cell with me, she was there throughout those 14 years. And just the same way that I was deprived of my own freedom, she was also deprived of hers. Next slide, please. In 2015, I was placed in the security and housing unit at Pelican Bay State Prison in Crescent City, California. And I would remain here for the remainder of my sentence, which was 5 years. It was here I began a process of self-reflection that allowed me to deconstruct my life and put my life into context within the social structure, systems, and institutions. It was in the SHU where I discovered my passion for education. I finally realized that with education comes knowledge, with knowledge comes wisdom, and with understanding comes the power to change. My transformation was a process that manifested over time. And it was not an individual endeavor. I recognized and acknowledged the people who shared their light in the darkness of the SHU. In the SHU, I learned to apply my love of knowledge and turn it into something beautiful. Education has given me a second chance at life, even when I thought I didn't have a second chance, because I felt like I'd never even had a first chance, right? You know, I want to talk about the people, you know, that I was in the SHU with, right? People that had been designated the worst of the worst, people that had been thrown away into solitary confinement for 20, 30 years. When they found out that I was going home and that I was gonna only be there for 5 years, it was them who really encouraged me to first, you know, obtain my GED. You know, they encouraged me to read. You know, it's interesting that Pelican Bay has one of the most robust libraries. Pelican Bay, not just Pelican Bay, but solitary confinement has one of the most robust libraries that I've ever seen while incarcerated. But in general population, you know, the libraries that I had access to were mediocre at best, you know? And so it was interesting that, you know, in order to get an education, you literally had to go to solitary confinement because in general population, it was non-existent, you know? But while I was there, I took the advice of my friends and started my GED. You know, after completing my GED, I started my correspondence courses through Coastline Community College, right? And maybe about 2 years before coming home, you know, I started my college education. I came home with about 48 units, not really knowing what I wanted to do, right? I just knew that I already had it in my mind that I wanted to finish at least my AA. You know, that was the goal. I started my AA in prison. I want to at least finish that. And it was, I'm not going to lie, it was a very ego-driven thing, right? It wasn't because, you know, I thought it was going to give me a better opportunity. I just like something I wanted. I started this, I got to finish it, right? And, you know, luckily, I had that attitude of at least wanting to go back to school, right? Because when I got to school, it was just, you know, an opportunity of a lifetime. Next slide, please. So this is me in my graduation at Cerritos College. But before getting to this point, you know, it was a 2.5 year effort, right? An effort that was not done alone, right? I remember immediately upon my release, a childhood friend came to my house when she heard that I wanted to continue my education. She was a student at Cerritos College. That same day, she took me to campus, walked me around campus, showed me all the different spaces on campus that were there to support students. Even though there was no program for formerly incarcerated students, there were still programs there that helped me because of different identities that I had, right? Whether it was a reentry student, whether it was a first generation student, you know, whether it was a program for Latino students, you know, there was things there that really catered to me and to my different identities that I brought with me to campus, right? You know, I remember I didn't start school until about 6 months after I was released, but I would go to campus every opportunity I had when I wasn't being called to go to work to a warehouse on behalf of an agency, right? Where I was just unloading trailers all day, boxes from trailers all day. You know, when I wasn't called to work, I would go to campus and do walk-in counseling with different counselors and just ask questions, ask lots of questions. You know, what can I do, you know? And when I felt comfortable enough and safe enough, I would expose, you know, why I had so many questions, you know? And there was one counselor in particular, Gloria Morales. She was an academic counselor at Cerritos College. And she told me, Puente, you need to get in Puente. And so that was, you know, something that definitely transformed my life. You know, another moment that was very transformative at community college was on one of those days that I was going to the counselor's office. I remember, I was walking into the admissions building and walking out with a childhood friend who was also formerly incarcerated. He served, you know, about 10 years incarcerated, you know, juvenile facilities and state prisons. And he didn't remember me, right? You know, at this point I had long hair, which was not something that we do in LA, right? We're always with bald heads when it comes to Chicanos. And, you know, anyways, you know, he walked right in front of me and I called his name, you know, and we started a conversation. You know, he asked me what I'm doing here. You know, I told him I'm trying to continue what I started in Pelican Bay Shoe, and I just want to get my AA and maybe get a job. And I asked him, what are you doing here? And he said, look, man, I just got my AA. I'm transferring to UC Irvine. I'm doing pre-med. I want to be a brain surgeon. And when he told me that, you know, I was in awe and inspired. I've known my friend since I was a kid. And, you know, he always grew up very smart, very capable of, you know, just doing things, right? You know, I have these stories about him stealing a car, you know, and turning it on in less than 60 seconds, right? He knew how to hotwire cars in less than 60 seconds. And for me, when he told me he wanted to be a brain surgeon, I thought about him stealing a car, right? Him wiring these wires inside a car to get it to start, right? And then I thought about, you know, brain surgery, you know, I'm sure it's a lot more complicated than that, but it's also about wiring, you know, and working with people's brains, right? It's very technical, very hands-on. And he knew how to do those things, right? And, you know, and it goes back to the lack of opportunities, right? My friend was already very, very capable, very intelligent, but he never had a chance to put that intelligence to use when we were kids, right? So we engage in negative activity with the skills and knowledge that we had. Instead of putting it into something positive, we put it into something negative that ended up costing us our time, a lot of time with our family and even our future, right? And so, you know, when my friend told me that this is what he wanted to do, and, you know, he kind of broke it down to me of what he did to get to that next level, you know, and he told me, man, you know, you don't have to just get your AA. If that's what you want to do, that's cool. But if you want to transfer and you want to go to a Cal State or UC in a private, which is possible, this is what you do, man. You make the community college your community, your space, right? Everybody here, see everybody here as a resource willing to help you, but it's all about you making that commitment and asking for that help. You know, if you don't ask for that help, it won't come to you, you know, but if you put yourself out there, connect with your professors, connect with your academic counselors, your tutors at the Writing Center, the Math Center, get into Puente, Umoja, these affinity groups, the Honor Scholars Program, you know, EOPS. These are all spaces that are there to help you succeed. And when he told me that, you know, it isn't like he just handed me the football and I just ran with it, you know, and I did exactly that. I turned that community college into my support center, right? It was my sanctuary. And without the people at community college, I don't know if I would have been able to accomplish all that I have accomplished now, right? But it was there that I set the foundation to what my future can possibly look like. Next slide, please. In 2012, I transferred to UC Berkeley for the fall semester. And I remember before transferring, right? Before school started, first day of school, I moved up there about maybe 2 to 3 weeks before the start of classes. And I just wanted to go to campus and walk around and get a feel for the place, right? And introduce myself to my ethnic studies advisor, to faculty members in the department, to meet folks at the Transfer Reentry Student Parent Center, meet people at EOP. And for me, I was just pretty much doing the same thing that I did at community college, right? I was looking for my community, right? And on the first day of school, you know, I'm at the Transfer Reentry Student Parent Center, and I see a gentleman, you know, a white guy, standing at a distance from me, but I'm checking him out, and there's just something about his demeanor, you know, that kind of called my attention. And, you know, I automatically stereotyped him. He's either military or he's formerly incarcerated, or he's both. And little by little, I kind of made my way towards him, and I got close enough, you know, where, you know, I introduced myself, and, you know, the conversation went something like this, right? I told him, you know, I feel kind of strange around all these young people. And he's like, yeah, me too, you know? And I said, you know, I've been away from school, you know, for a while. And you know, and he goes, yeah, me too. He goes, and I told him I was on vacation. He goes, yeah, me too. And I told him I was in Pelican Bay Shoe. He goes, yeah, me too. And, you know, that was, I was dumbfounded, right? You know, and never did I think I was gonna run into someone who had also been in Pelican Bay Shoe. Here we are, two formerly incarcerated men who have been designated by the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation as the worst of the worst of California state prison population. But yet, here we are at UC Berkeley, right? An institution that is internationally known, you know, one of the best institutions in California. And now we, you know, we're literally now considered the best of the best, right? It was a moment that, you know, made me realize who else is here, you mean? And I dedicated myself after that moment to start looking for my community, you know? And when I talk about community, I'm talking about people that were formerly incarcerated, you know? I started sharing my story with other people on campus, you know, and little by little, people started popping out, you know, whether they were formerly incarcerated or had family members that had been system impacted, you know. And I remember we came together to start a reading group, right? It was a reading group that was led by two faculty members in the Ethnic Studies Department, Patricia Pat Hilden and Victoria Robinson, both professors in the department and lecturers. And they organized a reading group. We called it the Critical Prison Studies Reading Group. And we recruited students that were formerly incarcerated and system impacted to participate in different conversations about incarceration, mass incarceration, the prison industrial complex. And as we're having these conversations and reading the literature, we start asking ourselves, like, you know, what else can we do besides just sit here and read and discuss the literature? What can we do? And that's when, you know, it occurred to us, like, you know, why not start something like Project Rebound at San Francisco State? You know, Project Rebound had a program for formerly incarcerated students that had been in existence at that point for almost more than 40 years. And so for us, we made it, we dedicated ourselves to starting a space. You know, we started with the student club, you know, and eventually we were able to find funding through the university, through student government. Student government gave us a grant of $135,000. And we used this grant to start a space, a center, just, you know, just buy some computers, some sofas, a microwave, things that students needed in that moment, right? Of course, we were also planning for the future, you know, and we were very idealistic about what we wanted. We wanted to end mass incarceration, the prison industrial complex overnight. But we also realized, you know, we need to take our time and take baby steps, right? And you know, in that process, you know, of doing this work for the last, you know, 7 years that Underground Scholars has been in existence, right? We are now going to different universities in California and different UC universities. You know, we have a program at UCLA, Bruin Underground Scholars. There's a program at UC Santa Cruz. And there's a few UC campuses in the process of starting a program. And almost every UC Underground campus has an Underground Scholars student organization, right? And the goal is really to continue to support formerly incarcerated students as they transition from incarceration into the community colleges, and they figure out what their next steps are in either going to a Cal State or a UC. As they come to the UCs, you know, Underground Scholars is there to support them. If they go to the Cal States, Project Rebound is there to support them. But really trying to establish a statewide network for all students to be supported and to be able to succeed after incarceration. Next slide, please. Since I've graduated from UC Berkeley in 2015, I've had the opportunity to be put in positions where I become an advocate for higher education in prison and for education for formerly incarcerated people. I have continued to, you know, be invited to different panels to share my experience, right? About being formerly incarcerated, being a student, and the work that I'm doing, right? But for me, you know, one of the most important things, right, besides going to these spaces, whether it's, you know, campus, colleges and universities, or giving lectures at for foundations and nonprofits, is seeing people that are coming after us, right? Seeing that folks, you know, are also becoming leaders in their own right, and also continuing to push for not just access to education, but also pushing to dismantle a lot of the laws and barriers that continue to keep us in a position of marginalization, right? And you know, I've had the opportunity to meet great folks like Alex Vanda at Fresno, you know, from Fresno, right? But he was a student at Fresno City College. He's now at Fresno State, you know. I see the work that he's doing in his community and on campus, supporting formerly incarcerated students, you know, and also bringing the community together, especially when issues of violence happen, right? And bringing folks together to find a resolution that's not going to continue the violence, right? Then there's, you know, going to prison, right? This picture below right here, it means a lot to me because these are gentlemen that are also from the same area that I'm from, but from different communities and, you know, or different gangs. And we don't get along, right, out here. But in prison, these were my brothers. These were people that, you know, showed me that I could do something with my life after incarceration. So for me to go back and support them and seeing them, not just them, but seeing prisons and institutions, seeing the culture change because of the impact that higher education has on these men, right? And the way that it's reducing the violence and the tension amongst people, right? That for me is the ultimate goal, because a lot of these men are gonna be coming home, men and women and people, right? Including trans people, right? Are gonna be coming home, and they need that support to be able to continue their education, to be able to transform themselves, their families, and their communities. Next slide, please. So now, I'm currently find myself at Cal State Long Beach. I'm pursuing my master's in education. And going back to school has, you know, unfortunately it's been on Zoom, but it's been a great experience, right? Because I'm coming back to the literature that really inspired me to pursue education, you know, the literature that really talked to me and talked about me, right? You know, that really took my life experience and looks at it as a learning experience, right? And this is what I want to do as I continue my education, right? In the Master's of Education in the Social Cultural Analysis program, is take what I learned here, take what I've learned through my experience, and take that with me for when I pursue my own career, hopefully as a community college instructor, right? I want to take everything that I've learned and be able to work with students, you know, not just formerly incarcerated students, but students from marginalized communities, and encourage them to understand that our life experience has meaning and our life experience has value. And that through life, our life experience, we can definitely use that as motivation to transform our lives, our families, and our communities. Next slide, please. You know, I talked about a lot about the transformation of education and the way it can transform the individual and families and communities. Before I came home from prison, my little brother and my nephew, they were teenagers, and they would write me letters, you know, thinking that I was going to come home and continue the same thing that the same thing that got me into prison, you know. And I would write back to them at times, look, that's not what I'm doing. That's not what I'm about, and that's not what I'm going to get involved with. You know, I'm coming out here with the intention of living a different life. If I have to be broke because of that choice, that I would rather be broke than in prison. You know, but they were infatuated with that lifestyle. They were part of the street gang, the same street gang that I'm from. You know, it's not even a street gang for us. It's just part of our reality. It's our community, right? So many of us have been caught up in this cycle for generations. And so when I came home, the only thing that I could do is talk to my brother and my nephew, you know, and impart on them the same knowledge and wisdom that people imparted upon me. And most importantly, it set a different example, because young people, they're not dumb. You know, they see the talk and they see the actions. And if your actions are not matching your talk, they're not going to take you seriously. And so for me, it was important that I role model an example that I was talking about. If I was telling them to pursue their education, it was because it was something that I was doing. And, you know, earlier today, Chancellor Eli Oakley said that a lot of black and brown youth and people, right, find themselves caught up in the justice system or the carceral system. And it happens a lot when, you know, someone is at the wrong place at the right time, at the wrong time, right? And so for me, when I transferred to Berkeley, you know, it was an opportunity to put my brother and my nephew it was the right place at the right time. You know, I moved in with me to UC Berkeley. The environment was very different than where we were coming from. They weren't being policed for smoking weed. They weren't being policed for drinking. On the contrary, you know, everybody at the university smokes and drinks, right? So, you know, it's not something that gets policed, right? Like in our communities. And so, but what they also had was access to a community of formerly incarcerated people, gang-labeled people, gang-identified people, people that have been labeled gang members, people that, you know, have been in prison, in jail, have been shot at, you know, have been beaten by police, but they were also students at UC Berkeley. And for my brother and for my nephew to be around, not just me, but also around these other individuals who were formerly incarcerated at UC Berkeley, it definitely gave them a different perspective and allowed them to see the world through a different lens, right? And for me, you know, one of my goals has always been to make sure that I break the cycles of incarceration that exist in my family. And that was something that I dedicated myself to and would not have been possible without higher education. You know, I'm proud to say that even though my brother and my nephew ended up incarcerated, juvenile facilities, jails, and prisons, my little brother is now an undergraduate student at UC Santa Barbara, pursuing a double major in sociology and poli-sci. My nephew, he's been cooking since he was 8 years old. You know, when he was in prison, he was a lead cook. And when he came home, He got a job at the University of California as a cook and is currently pursuing his culinary arts degree at Laney College with the intention of transferring to Cal Poly Pomona to pursue a bachelor's in restaurant and business management. You know, I've accomplished a lot, right? And one can say that, you know, I've done what I've done and I can just sit back and relax and just enjoy my life. But I think as long as people continue to be oppressed, as long as people continue to choose to want to make a difference in their life, I want to be there to support them. I want to be a bridge for people that are coming out of incarceration, coming home, wanting to change. And I want to be able to provide those opportunities the same way I provide them for myself and for my family. Thank you very much.
Danny, so much. Thank you from all of us. Really can't thank you enough. Since we have a little bit of time before the next breakout session, which is gonna start at 10:20, I wanted to ask you if you wouldn't mind answering any questions that might be in the chat. I can read them to you, and if you wouldn't mind addressing them, I would appreciate that. And I know our participants would also appreciate that. I also want to encourage our audience and our participants to throw a question in the chat if you have a question that you would like to pose to Danny, and then we'll filter through those and I can read them, and then you could address them if you wouldn't mind, Danny.
Yeah, for sure.
Wonderful. So I'm going to go through the questions now. Yeah, again, so if you have questions for Danny, please feel free to throw them in the chat, and we'll do our best to address those.
There are some questions in the Q&A, and one was, what could have changed your path? That... as a young person, you know, definitely mental health services, right? Therapy. But I also, I came from a community where we didn't know what that was, and we weren't, and we looked at those things as with suspicion, right? And even much more so in prison, right? You couldn't talk to a mental health service provider in prison because it was looked at as a sign of weakness, right? So for me, you know, as I, you know, even when I came home, my mentor in community college would always tell me, Danny, go talk to DSP. And for me, I was like, nah, man, that's not for me. You know what I mean? I don't need that. But what I didn't know is that I was doing the same thing that I would do in therapy. I was doing that with my mentor. I would hold myself up in his office for an hour and just unpack everything. You know, and he would give me that space, you know, where I would just unpack everything, a lot of my trauma as a child, things that I was living in that moment, the anxiety of having a little brother and nephew who was out there in the streets, always worrying about what happened if they get shot, what am I going to do, you know, and he would always tell me, like, Danny, you should go see a therapist, and I would tell him no, but he would still give me that space, and it wasn't until I got to Berkeley that it was someone who I would consider an enemy in prison, right? But who looked just like me, you know? He was my friend, and he told me, Danny, also a formerly incarcerated person, hey, Danny, you should go to therapy. You know, you need it, you know? And when he told me that, when it was coming from someone who has the same experience as me, been incarcerated, been in solitary, and he's telling me this, that's when it resonated with me. Because it was coming from someone who also lived through what I lived through and was not looking at therapy as a sign of weakness, right? And I learned in that moment that needing help is not a sign of weakness. It's a sign of strength to be able to come to the conclusion and say, you know what? I can't do this alone. I need help. And asking for that help, that's the ultimate sign of strength. There's another question, I guess, on the Q&As, like I can go, that I'm looking at. I can go through them if you want.
Yeah, Daniel, let me go ahead and read this one to you, okay? Okay. I'll read the question for the audience, and then yeah, you can respond to this one. This one is from, this looks like Marisa Gamboa. Thank you, Danny, for sharing your story. You are courageous and inspiring. You said a friend motivated you with his words, felt like he handed you a football and you ran with it. What an analogy. Keep running with that football. I do the same thing in my work with my school's rising scholars. So I guess that was a kudos and affirmation and appreciation. I thought it was a question, but
thank you, Marisa.
This is a great question here. This is from Rosa Alcarzar. What can I say in my classroom to show that I believe in redemption? I do this, but maybe you have some tips to help my students know I am there to support them.
I would definitely say the literature, right? If you're in the classroom, then definitely include the literature that speaks to the students that are in your class, right? I was reading books, right? I remember reading Always Running in a juvenile facility. And when I read it, I didn't read it with the purpose of learning. I just read it because of everything that I was talking about, the gang violence. And I was glorifying that, right? And I thought that he was also glorifying that. But when I read it years later in solitary confinement, it resonated very differently, right? I realized that Luis Rodriguez was an intelligent person who had skills and certain knowledges that weren't valued, right? And weren't nurtured, right? But through perseverance and resilience, he was able to become a published author, right? And that was what resonated with me after I read it. And it resonated with me because I identify with him. You know, we grew up in different eras, but we grew up in the same environments, right? Gang-related, Chicano communities. And that definitely spoke to me once I was able to understand the literature on a much deeper level.
Wow, that's great. Thank you for that, Danny. Some very great ways to include some tangible practices in the classroom, right? We got a couple more.
Real quick, for young women, I a book I bought for my sobrinas was Sandra Cisneros' A House on Mango Street, right? So something, you know, things like that, right?
Absolutely. Books and text and literature that is affirmative, validating, and acknowledges the realities in intersecting identities, right, of systems impacted and carceral impacted students. So we have a couple great questions I'd like to read to you since we do have a little bit of time here, Danny.
Yeah.
And this question is specifically about faculty, so or institutional barriers rather, not faculty, practitioners, staff, admin, and community college. Are there any barriers from college instructors that stood out to you? Is there anything you wish they had done differently to support you?
To be honest with you, no. I've always, you know, I went to community college, you know, letting my guard down, right? And I think it was very important for me to do that, right? I remember one time I had a conversation with an academic counselor, and she said something that had I not let my guard down, it could have probably had rubbed me the wrong way, but I just took it as a joke, right? I had an appointment with the walk-in counselor. I give her my transcripts from prison. She doesn't know they're from prison, but she's looking at my transcript. They're like, wow, you got excellent grades. Like, wow, this is amazing. You know, and as we're talking, I told her, look, I was in prison. And then she said, oh, well, no wonder you got amazing grades. You got all day to study. And well, guess what? I do. I literally did have all day to study. I wasn't myself all day. I didn't tell her that, but I didn't take that as an offense, you know, and she kind of laughed and I laughed with her, right? And I understand that it could have possibly rubbed other people the wrong way, right? But I think for me, I also realized that maybe it was a way for her to cut the tension, right? Not knowing if it was appropriate or not, but I wasn't going to hold that against her, you know? So for me, you know, I also stepped into these positions like, all right, I'm gonna let my guard down and not take everything personal, you know? And you know, but she ended up being my friend, right? She ended up, you know, being someone that was supportive of me. She ran the transfer center, right? And so she supported me in my transfer process, right? So, you know, on the contrary, I think for me, it's been much more so supportive, right? You know, real quick, I talk about, you know, when I was in my last semester at community college. I had a workload, you know, and personal workload with my little brother, my nephew, workload on campus with, you know, work studies and my student load. And so I was doing my algebra math, right? My last transfer math, which, you know, everybody tells me like, don't do that at the end, but here I go. I do it at the last semester and it was just too much. I couldn't do it. And my mentor, Armando Soto, right, tells me, academic counselor, he was an academic counselor at Cerritos College at the time. Now he's a dean at Santa Ana College. And he tells me, like, Danny, whatever you do, don't drop the class. Even if you failed it, don't drop the class. You know, and, you know, I remember checking in with my professor, like, yo, I need to pass this class. I need to pass this class. And he gave me a bunch of chances to pass the class, right? But unfortunately, it was just too, I wasn't prepared. And I failed the class. Ultimately, I failed the class. I submitted an appeal to UC Berkeley right then and there. As soon as I failed the class, I submitted an appeal, told him, look, I didn't pass the class with the grade that I needed to transfer. I was already admitted. The folks at UC Berkeley had a meeting, told me, look, just pass it with the B in the summer, you're good. I was already enrolled in the class, same professor. And, you know, he worked with me, right? Like he worked with me, literally worked with me those whole 8 weeks. I mean, I would go to his office hours. He'd give me time by myself. You know, I was in the math center from 8 a.m. to 10 o'clock at night, you know. And if anything, you know, in that moment, the college kind of came together to really just to support me in that course for 8 weeks, you know. And so I say that to say that, you know, my experience for the most part has been positive with faculty and staff at community college. And at UC Berkeley, I can't really say much about Long Beach because I'm not really there. I'm always on Zoom. And so I don't get personal when people don't respond to my emails because I know right now things are taking a little long because of everything that's happening. But for the most part, I've always go into situations, you know, putting my best foot forward. And if people can't accept me for that, then that's on them. But for the most part, it's been great.
Wonderful. Here's a question, if you're willing, Danny.
For sure.
This question is, with the recent dismantling of the DJJ, what is your view of the so-called diversion programs to replace incarceration, especially for youth?
I know that from my understanding, what I know about it is that most, all of the youth are being diverted back to their county of origin, right? But at the same time, a lot of those youth who still have a lot of time and are adults are being sent to adult facilities. Wherever they end up at, my hope is that they have access to all the resources that they need to start the process to come home, right? Reentry doesn't start the day you come home. It's to start the day you go in, right? And the services should be provided for you to start making different choices, right? And so, you know, I'm a big advocate for higher education, right? But also making sure that it's quality education. I'm a big advocate for the self-help groups, the groups that teach you about insight, about personal responsibility and accountability. Even though we do live in a system that has a lot of inequality, has a lot of injustices, there is still a part of me that has to take accountability for my actions, right? And knowing what I know now, I'm not that same kid no more that doesn't have control of his emotion, right? And so being a lot more grown and wiser is imparting on people those same skills to be able to make better decisions, right? And that comes through internal healing, right? And if we don't have that, right, you can give somebody access to education and everything, but if you don't give them the internal healing, they're always going to be something that can go wrong and cause relapse and can set everything off track.
Thank you for that. Powerful, especially your comment about the internal healing, right? It's important, but I also think that the necessary like environments, conditions, and support need to be there to help with that internal healing as well, right? So the environment, the support with each other. So thank you for that, Danny. We do have a couple more questions. And since we do have time, if you don't mind, I'd like to pose these. There are some pretty good questions here. This next one is, many students also see tutorial as something for quote, dumb, end quote, students. How do we help students understand that tutorial services serve their scholar identity? Tutorial services are for scholars.
No, you know, definitely. I love tutors. Right? I love even effective tutors. And I had the experience of meeting so many in community college, at UC Berkeley, and even at Cal State LA, especially the writing tutors and the math tutors, right? But even not just the tutors, right? But even like your colleagues, right? Like the other formerly incarcerated students that you're learning with, right? For me, one of the best learning experiences was talking to other formerly incarcerated students who were not ethnic studies. And, you know, I have a very good friend of mine. He was a comparative literature major, and I was ethnic studies. And I would explain to him what I was learning, and vice versa. He would explain to me what he was learning. And that gave us a better understanding of the material. When you're able to explain it to someone that doesn't know it, and then they can ultimately understand it, then you have a pretty good grasp of the material, right? And for me, it was those conversations, you know, with friends and with tutors, right? Especially at the writing center, right? And especially with folks that know the material that you're writing about, right? Because it kind of gets like that once you're more like at the graduate level, right? Now you're going to a tutor more specifically, maybe in your field, right? And so those conversations are so much fruitful to your scholarship and to your growth as a scholar, right? And, you know, I can, you know, definitely again, going back to like the same thing as going to DSP, right? Seeking out a tutor is not a sign of weakness. It's actually a sign of strength and a sign that you see your limited capacities and willing to grow from there.
Thank you, Danny. So we have one more question, and we'll find it here. How can those of us who go into the prisons promote therapy as a positive thing inside a prison?
If you're not formally incarcerated, I think the best way is to give examples or even literature of people that have went through that process, or people that have wrote about that process from the perspective of someone that was incarcerated or formerly incarcerated. Also, if you run a prison education program, I would encourage you, if there's a program on your campus, to recruit some of the students to go in there and you know, not just recruit as token pieces, but give them jobs to go in there as outreach coordinator or actually in-reach coordinator, and to share their testimony, right? About, you know, especially those that have went through that process of that internal healing. And it's not something that just, it's an overnight thing. It's something that you work on every day, right? For the rest of your life, right? But seeing people going through that process that had that same experience, it definitely means a lot, right? And it did for me when someone told me, Danny, you need therapy. And it wasn't like, nah, bro, you don't know what you're talking about. Like, it was like, oh, actually, really? All right. And it was because of that person. You know what I mean? So it's definitely seeing folks that can role model examples of what internal healing can do for someone. It does a lot.
Wonderful. Well, we're getting a few questions and we do have time. So I'm going to go ahead and pose them, Danny. This is a great question at the end of a statement here, but to contextualize a question, let me go ahead and read the whole thing, okay? I work directly with incarcerated students at our school. I know there can be many things you can share, as you have with us this morning. Your story is amazing and I will be sharing with my students. If there was one message of hope, advice, or anything I can share with our students, what would that be?
That your life can't be defined by that moment, by that mistake that landed you in jail. There's still a whole future ahead of you. I mean, and there are opportunities to move forward, right? And there are many examples of people doing exactly that. People that were formerly incarcerated, you know, from young people from 18 to 19 years old that have transformed their lives, to people at, you know, at 59, 60 years old that are now pursuing their master's. Right, there are so many rich examples of people moving forward with their lives after incarceration, that is, you know, it is a mark, it is a barrier, but there are possibilities and opportunities to overcome those barriers and to transform your life.
Wow. Absolutely. That is so thoughtful and so powerful. And I hope that the person who posed that question, and really anyone who works with system impacted or carceral impacted or formerly incarcerated individuals, keeps that in mind. I think that's some really sage advice. Danny, thank you so much. That's very, very thoughtful. That one moment in your past, right, or a series of moments that may have led to a place where you don't want to be. It's not the defining moment, right? It doesn't predict the future per se, right? It's about breaking those cycles and breaking systematic forms of oppression. And you know, that's a wonderful way to uplift our community. So again, thank you for that. That was very, very thoughtful. So I'm going through our questions here to see if we have a couple more that came in. Oh, this is great. Okay, Danny, you ready for this one? Is there any idea you received early on in life that has stuck with you throughout your transformation, one you have developed to use as a seed to plant in others' minds that you believe can grow to change them in positive ways?
Yeah, definitely. And it was something that at first, I was expressing that through, how can I say this? I always look out for people, right? And I love supporting people, right? I support a lot of formerly incarcerated people and incarcerated people. And that was also something that I did prior to my incarceration and even during my incarceration. But prior to my incarceration, my support was, you know, I wanted to help people make money, right? But the thing is that I was giving them drugs to make money, right? I was giving them drugs to sell to people in our community so that they can have money in their pocket, be able to buy themselves some clothes and put food on their table, right? Even though, you know, we were doing things that were also destroying people's lives, for me, it was coming from a place of love, but that's the only thing that I knew, right? That was the only way I knew how to look out for people. And similar with my experience in prison. When I was in prison and my friends were showing me how to make a prison knife, it wasn't because they wanted me to go get in trouble. They were showing me how to survive. And that was coming from a place of love, but that's all we knew. That's all we knew how to express our love, right? And now is taking on that same spirit, but doing it in a way where it's not about surviving, but showing love to people to help them to be able to thrive, right? And I think that's definitely something that I carry with me.
Thank you, Danny. The power of love, right? I bring love to my work and my racial equity work and social justice work at Fresno City College, and I trust my colleagues know that as well. And, you know, I talk about it often. I do center love in my work, and so to hear you talk about something that has been so meaningful and so influential in your experience and that has stuck with you, right, throughout your transformation to present. It's very encouraging for me, for one, and certainly I trust for the entire audience, all of our participants, the power of love, right? And we learn our ways of knowing, right? They're informed by our upbringing and our communities, and that's all we know, our communities and our upbringing, right? Until you learn otherwise. Sure. So the power of love can really transform. I appreciate that. A couple of questions here. What books or resources do you recommend on learning more about this issue or to help teachers understand this issue?
I'm assuming like the issue of formerly incarcerated students. I would say definitely read my report, right? I recently released a report on that highlights the barriers that formerly incarcerated students encounter in California's public colleges and universities. We also provide a set of recommendations in the report that addresses a lot of the barriers that came up in the report. For instance, probation, parole, housing, unemployment, direct student support services, and career advisors, right? Or, you know, career advisors that know about the impact of felony and misdemeanor convictions, right? And arrest histories. Other books, I guess if you want like a broader understanding of mass incarceration, you know, there's A New Jim Crow by Michelle Alexander. That kind of gives you an understanding of the systemic issue of mass incarceration. What else? You know, this is a real more theoretical, so a little bit more dense, but it's a book on how California ended up having 30 something prisons in their state, right? It's the Golden Gulag by Dr. Ruthie Gilmore, right? Dr. Ruthie Gilmore. That's a book that's you know, it's pretty dense, but it has a lot of information about California's expansion and their disinvestment in higher education, right? I think you might have to just follow up on an email, and I can definitely send you a list of books, right? But off the top of the head, like really nothing's popping up. I just have just maybe the books that I have around me right now. You know, Bell Hooks is what I'm reading for school. Angel Dua, I'm reading for school right now. Jimmy Santiago Vaca. But yeah.
Yeah, no doubt. You know, I think we could talk about just a litany of text and books, right? For colleagues to read and consider as it relates to teaching, right? But I think what I would add is that, you know, to contextualize, right, the systemic issue of mass incarceration and the intersection of education, there's a documentary on Netflix. So if you have access to Netflix, the documentary called The 13th, which is in reference to the 13th Amendment. I think that's maybe even a starting point in addition to the books that Danny recommended. Just it really, I think, helps contextualize the true atrocious impact of the mass incarceration system in this nation, right? So there's books, right, Danny? There's books. There's published material, and that's an accessible documentary. You know, if you have Netflix and whatnot, it's pretty good. I'll also give a shout out to a mutual colleague of Danny and mine, and that's Dr. Melissa Abeta, who is on the call joining us today and will be facilitating a breakout session later on. Actually, Melissa has published some material on the experience of formerly incarcerated and carceral impacted individuals in education and specifically in community colleges. So that's something you could look up. And you know what, I think what we'll do also, Danny, is somewhere in the CVENT website today, we can create a link to resources, to literature, to peer-reviewed material, and just resources in general for educators on how to better understand the situation and how to redress the disparities that carceral impacted students experience on a daily. So thanks for that question, great question. I'm looking through our questions here to see if any new ones came through. And we do have two more, and I'm glad we have time because this allows for some engagement, right? Some dialogue and some discussion. And this question is, as we advise these students, how can we as counselors help make the session more effective and help them feel we truly care so they do not leave thinking they have been judged? What verbiage do you advise us to use or not to use?
Yeah, thank you. I'm definitely starting off with human-centered language, right? Not referring to someone as an ex-con or an ex-prisoner, but, you know, as a person, right? Whether it's a formerly incarcerated person, a person that was a person that's on parole, probation. There's an undergrad scholars at UC Berkeley has a language guide that has different terms that are centered around human-centered language. And then that's something that I always advise folks to see. I'll see if I can find the link and post it on the chat. Also, I wanted to mention, you know, for or other ways that counselors can support is knowing before, you know, you even talk to students, like what are the issues impacting them, in particular around career choices, right? The more informed that you are, the better prepared you'll be able to support them, right? Unfortunately, a lot of times, sometimes folks don't understand that they can't pursue a master's or a specific master's because it comes with the licensing barrier, right? And they don't know that, you know, until they got their face with that barrier, then they realize, whoa, you mean to tell me I spent all this time pursuing this education and I was never going to be able to get a job because of, you know, the particular conviction history barriers that exist. So I think having that type of information early on to kind of help folks navigate the possibilities of career options is important, right? And, you know, definitely also, if you are in a position, right, to provide opportunities, right, whether they're employment opportunities, whether leadership opportunities, these are things that a lot of us are lacking, right? We've never been put in we've never been trusted to be put in leadership positions, right? You know, putting that trust in people really shows them that you care and that you're willing to make the commitment to support them in their educational goals and aspirations.
Excellent. And it looks like we have one more question here in our chat. Danny, I have some similarities. I consider dealing drugs as a career. I was lucky enough that my transformation came about when I saw what happened to others. Are you trying to reach those that are going in that direction, but could still wake up before they end up in jail?
So I think it's a question saying, am I working with folks that haven't transitioned into jail, but are kind of like in that direction?
Right. It looks like the question is saying, are you still trying to reach out to those who are headed the direction, but could still wake up before they end up in jail? It's the last part of the question.
Well, I guess I would say for the most part, most of my work is really with folks that are just coming home, right? You know, people that are, and usually, you know, I'm not out. I have a job, I'm a student, all that. But then, you know, there are students or people that are coming home that will reach out to me like, yeah, I just came home, you know, I'm just trying to figure it out. And I would be, you know, I don't become their official mentor, but, you know, I am, you know, like a de facto mentor, and I support them, you know, in terms of helping them process things, right, or choices, right, that they should consider making for their next steps in terms of what they want to pursue in their education. You know, I definitely, one of the things that I love to do is I love to kind of assess people and like, okay, what do you love? What are you good at? What are your interests? And how do we combine that to think about a future career, right? And it usually doesn't necessarily, you know, have to be something specific, right? Like I went to Berkeley with pursuing a bachelor's in ethnic studies. And, you know, I ended up as a program analyst at the Vera Institute of Justice. I ended up as a completion counselor at Rutgers University. Not necessarily things that I was studying for, but these were just doors that were open. Because most importantly, I seen the university as a treasure chest, but I wouldn't know how to find that treasure if I didn't go asking around, right? And as I walked around campus and I found all these different resources, I realized that there were so many other things that I could do besides being, I wanted to pursue a PhD. I love that whole academic thing. And then I realized I fell in love with wanting to teach at a community college. And I realized, oh, wait a minute. All I need is a master's to be able to do that. You mean, the PhD still sounds good. And I like the idea of getting a PhD. But ultimately, if I want to teach at a community college and work at a community college, I can do that with one, a bachelor's, and also with all of the networks that I've already established throughout California, right? With the work that I'm doing, supporting incarcerated and formerly incarcerated students, that's going to allow me to leverage opportunities to be able to step in into a community college campus.
Excellent. And we do have another question. And this question, just some context for the audience that, you know, really, I'm sure Danny's going to get to this, but this is a large question that I don't think as simple as providing a list of responses, because it's a systemic problem. And it's about job availability for formerly incarcerated individuals. So the question is there a resource or resources you can suggest for counselors to use concerning the availability of careers out there for formerly incarcerated individuals?
There's not one centralized resource, but I would throw out there some organizations, right? Root and Rebound, they do work around licensing barriers. The National Labor Employment, NELP, National Employment Labor Project, I believe. They're in Berkeley, California. They do a lot of work around licensing barriers for formerly incarcerated people. And there's a new organization starting up called the California System Impacted Bar Association. It was co-founded by two formerly incarcerated lawyers. And that organization is gonna, you know, in the future, as it becomes well-established, is gonna fight for people who are encountering licensing barriers, in particular for law school and the bar admissions, but they're also gonna be training lawyers to support people that are trying to get, you know, become clinical psychologists, right? So things like that, that require barriers. So they're gonna also train their lawyers to support folks in that field, right? That are in California, we have over 50 licensing agencies, right? And each of those is tasked with licensing over 200 different professional fields, right? From barber to beautician to lawyers, right? And everything in between. And every license has its own specific barrier regarding convictions and arrests. And so it's a lot. It's a lot for people to know. It's a lot for academic counselors to know, but having some type of centralized database that they can refer to, it's very, very much necessary and needed.
Wow, those are some wonderful resources. I went ahead and popped in the link for Root and Rebound. I also shared the link to the Underground Scholars Language Guide, the one that you referenced earlier. So I dropped that in the chat for everyone. These are some excellent resources. And again, these are some things that I'm taking note of that we'll include in a link that we can hopefully share out with participants at the end of the symposium tomorrow afternoon. So thank you for that. And I believe looks like that's it. We do have one more question, which is good because I think that's all we have time for before we transition here. And the question says, there is a serious lack of resources in the prisons, computers, et cetera. How can we support? And this is coming from a Fresno City College administrator.
Thank you for that question. I think right now at the state level, right, there's some a possible bill around incarcerated students, right? I think that's a start, right? Starting at the top, right? Seeing that there's some type of legislation that's gonna protect access to education for incarcerated students, and then also emphasize the need for quality education, right? And what that quality education looks like, you know, for the most part, we truly believe, I truly believe that face-to-face is the most important part of education in prison, right? And having the students in the classroom and having a faculty in there that's engaging and willing to meet students where they're at, that has a profound impact, right? Also, when that's not possible, then how can we make education interactive through technology, right? Similar to the way we're having a conversation here, right? One where it has to be interactive, one because that passive education where they're just on their tablet by themselves and not engaging in conversation with faculty and other students, it is not as engaging as being, you know, in the class, right? So really thinking about the quality of education that folks are getting. And then if that means that they need to get, you know, tablets and access to technology, well, how do we do that without compromising the safety also of the facility, right? Because I understand that there's a concern for that, right? So how do we do that with at the same time meaning the safety of the institution, right? And but definitely, I think for me, it starts at the top by setting legislation that's going to protect the rights of incarcerated students.
Wow, that's amazing. I had been keeping track of that bill. I'm when it was first initiated. I'm not sure where it's at now. And so for you to report out on that, that's encouraging. And you're absolutely right. It starts from the top, right? It's at the policy level. And I hope that comes to fruition. I hope it happens. It would be a truly wonderful thing and provide a lot of resources that are very, very much needed across the carceral system in the state. Danny, again, I know I've thanked you so many times since last year, right? We've been working on this project a couple of years now. But I, you know, on behalf of the planning committee and all my colleagues, our peer mentors, Alex Banda, Victoria Rocha, we really appreciate you sharing some of your experiences, your life experiences, your expertise, and even some of your wisdom, consejos, and recommendations for our participants. I also trust that by you sharing your lived experience and sharing some palabra and some word with us, that for our carceral impacted individuals that are joining us today, one, you're an inspiration, you're a beacon. And for our colleagues, friends, and community members who are non-carceral impacted or formerly incarcerated individuals, I trust that this opening keynote helped contextualize the symposium for today and for tomorrow. And so with that, I want to thank you all, and we hope you enjoyed this opening session for the symposium. We're going to transition to our breakout sessions now. I believe you have about a 10-minute break, right, Susie, I believe? And to access your breakout sessions that you either registered for, you should have an email in your inbox with information. My colleague, Susie, also dropped the links for the breakout sessions in the chat. So you have access to the breakout sessions right here in the chat. You can just click on them there. So again, about a 10-minute break. Please don't go far. I know this is virtual, but as the saying goes, don't go far, come back. And thank you all for being here. And we hope that you find the rest of the symposium meaningful. We'll see you later on this afternoon.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Ray.
Thank you.